first started, I didn't know about anything, like what is JavaScript, what is React, what is front end, what is back end. I had no clue about any of those things. So the first thing I did was I went through tutorials where they develop e-commerce website using React and a portfolio website using React. So I just followed the tutorial. I did the exact same thing that they did in the tutorial. So over time, I did like five, six projects, and I realized I can do it. But if someone come up with a new idea and ask me to develop a new system for them, I struggle because I can follow a tutorial, but I can't come up with my own solution. So same thing applied for cloud. I did a lot of things, but that didn't teach me the fundamentals of what I'm doing. When you're following a tutorial blindly, you don't learn fundamentals. So it's good to go through tutorials. It'll teach you what are the available technologies, how to do things. So the second stage was I stopped going through tutorials, and then when I wanted to go through a tutorial, I watched the whole video without stopping and doing coding. Then I understand what they're doing. Now after that, I just drew a diagram about the systems interconnecting with each other. Then I wanted to do it on my own. When I get stuck, I Googled about the solutions. I went through the documentation, how to do things, but I don't watch the same tutorial twice. I watch it once to understand what they're doing. After that, I do it on my own. So that's the second stage. And when you come to the third stage, you don't watch the tutorial at all. You just come up with an idea, then you come up with your own solution and you try to implement that. So these are the three stages of practicing your coding and cloud skills.
Yeah.
So when you come to third stage, you're actually ready for the industry.
It's a huge kind of jump actually for a lot of students. They're like, oh, like suddenly like a lot of the guardrails are being like taken away, you know, one by one. So your first stage, you were following kind of step-by-step tutorials, you were following along a video, and then in the second stage, you were like, oh, let me just watch the tutorial once. And then I'll try to implement it on my own. And then in the third stage, you were thinking, oh, let me start by drawing my own architecture diagram and solve all of this on my own. Can we run an example of this? Maybe I remember we talked about like a Kubernetes project. Can you kind of like do stage one, two, three with that kind of Kubernetes project as an example and how you would go?
So it's like when I was first starting to learn Kubernetes. So it's like I got a task to do at my first job in Kubernetes. I didn't know what is Kubernetes. So the first thing I did was I Googled how to deploy Kubernetes cluster. It just gave me a step-by-step guide. I just blindly followed that and I got a Kubernetes cluster. But after that, I didn't know what I did. I just followed the step-by-step guide and I got a Kubernetes cluster. That doesn't mean I know anything about Kubernetes. So then I went to the second stage. I learned what are the components involved in Kubernetes and how they interact with each other. Then I tried to, without going following the step-by-step guide, I tried to do everything on my own. Like I Googled what is Kubernetes, what is the purpose of using Kubernetes, what is Docker, what is a container. So I wanted to get answers for all these questions. So it helped me to build the big picture, like how Kubernetes work, what is etcd, what is kubelet doing. Like I got to know answers for all these questions. And right now, if I get a different requirement, I can come up with my own solution. I don't have to go through a tutorial. So I can rely only on the documentation without going through a step-by-step guide.
Yeah, that's cool. I mean, if anyone has any questions about that, please add that to the chat. I personally found this to be such an interesting part of Daham's learning journey that seems to be also an important part of that learning journey, like being able to like let go of the guardrails by yourself and go on that journey by yourself. So if you have any questions about like how Daham did that, if you have any requests on like, oh, Daham, like can you help me brainstorm on how I can do this on this project, this kind of concept, like add that to the chat and we can talk about that later in Q&A as well. But yeah, I'm fascinated by it. Like thinking
Yeah,
about
because This might not help you at the early stage of your career when you just join the company as a fresher. You want this might not help you because no one is expecting you to solve actual problems. So you can use existing knowledge and build something for them. But as you get into more senior levels, then people, company expect you to solve problems that no one else has solved earlier. So when you come to that stage, you can't Google for answers. You might not get answers for that. At that point, you will have to go and dig into the code base, dig into the documentation, and figure out how things work together and come up with your own solution. So it will help you to stand out in your career. But as a student, also, if you can build this skill, that will be very helpful.
Cool. It's cool to hear that, you know, in that second software engineering role where you started to get into cloud more, it sounded like that company, that their entire infrastructure, was it all on cloud for them? Like there was pretty much
everything was on cloud.
Yeah. And eventually you went from cloud newbie to probably someone that was like one of the go-to people for cloud, like at the workplace, like
I wouldn't say I became an expert during that job because I just now moved to a full-time cloud role. At that time, I was working as a software engineer, but at the same time, I helped them to deploy their applications in cloud. So it's like 70% of the time I was a software engineer, 30% of the time I was working in cloud and DevOps field.
I see. Okay, that's really helpful to know.
Yeah.
Would you say there were certain things that you almost had to do extra and at work to give yourself more opportunities to learn cloud? Or was it all given to you as a natural part of the role?
Yeah, because as I said earlier, at that time, I was the only one with some Kubernetes experience. So that gave me the opportunity to work in these requirements. So there were a lot of software engineers, but prior experience and some knowledge with cloud and EKS gave me the opportunity to work in those issues. So over time, when I got comfortable, I got more and more work related to cloud.
Yeah. Ooh.
Yeah. So you always need to have a reason to stand out.
Yeah. Okay. That's cool. I think when it comes to going from here to now moving full time into a cloud role, can you tell us like what that journey was like? Like how did you end up deciding to leave your previous job? How did you end up like getting into like the current one? Like walk us through that journey a little bit.
Yeah, so actually when I moved to this new role, when I moved to New Zealand, I completely gave up on my previous job and came here. So then I started looking for new jobs. So it's not like I directly moved from software to cloud. I gave up on the previous job and I wanted to look for a new job in New Zealand. That's why I moved to this new role. So, but during the transition, one thing helped me because this is something, one principle that I always believe. So when I study and when I try to improve my skills, I spend 70% of my time studying skills that are required to grow in my current role. And I spend 30% of my time to learn skills which will help me to move to the next role. So it's like when I was working as a software engineer, I was spending 70% of time understanding new code, learning new languages, how to optimize codes, writing clean code. That's what I did 70% of my time. And I spent 30% of my time learning something new about cloud, mostly Kubernetes, CI/CD pipelines, good DevOps practices. So I spent 30% of time on those things. And that 30% of time helped me to land this new job. Because I was not an expert when I got this new job. But that small efforts gradually helped me to land the new job.
And did you have to learn like a special kind of routine, or how did you end up like finding the time to learn all of the new things like on the side as well?
That's the tricky thing. You had to always put a lot of additional hours to learn new things. And when I was working also, it was not like a 9-to-5, 8-hour job. I think I have worked more than 12 hours some days I have even worked 18 hours in my first job.
Oh my gosh.
So it's a lot of hours into work. But I was happy to do that because every day was a learning opportunity for me. So at that time, I was okay with that. I had the energy to put additional hours into work.
Yeah.
But I don't recommend everyone to do like that. It just do what you like. If you like to learn something, just do it. It was not like someone forced me to work. And it was not exactly working because I asked for new work. I asked for things that I don't know. So it was up to me. No one put pressure on me. You have to do this. I asked for cloud work. I asked for EKS work because I wanted to learn. So that's why I spent additional hours. I wanted to learn and then applied in the job. So I think it's up to you. It's in your hand.
Yeah. And I think that resonates so well with like a lot of the members like in the community and NextWork as well. Like so many of them, they could be like working on something completely different. They're like, oh, I find this interesting. So I really want to do it. And in other cases, it's like, oh, it could be studying something completely different and I just really want to give it a go. Or they could be saying like, oh, I don't think I've been, I see this happening in the market. I know cloud is like becoming something that's bigger and bigger. I'm not like doing this directly at work right now, but I just want to be a part of something new. And I think that kind of curiosity really can drive like a huge change in people's lives. Like if they, if they take it so seriously and if they go down that path. So yeah, big kudos for on you as well for like spending that 30% of time into something that clearly paid off so well as well. And yeah, give us a little bit more of a story into like that early, almost like career seeking part of this year. Cause you landed the cloud role. What month was it when you landed, when you first started this?
I started in April.
In April? So how long was that job seeking phase for you?
I think I was looking for jobs for like, full-time, I was looking for jobs for like 2 months. And another month I spent like just applying for jobs, not very seriously. I was just casually applying for jobs. I would say I spent 2 months seriously applying for jobs.
Yeah. And tell us more about like those 2 months, because those 2 months are probably still like a slightly fresh experience for you. Kind of, well, stepped out a bit, probably like around April time. So what can you tell us more about like what was that like at the time for you, those 2 months?
It's challenging right now. The market is not good, but I can see it's getting better now. But a few months ago, the market was not that good. So there were less opportunities in New Zealand. And I was more focused on software jobs because that's what I had experience in. So I was in a new country and I didn't want to experiment on something new. Even though I had some experience in cloud, I was more confident with software development because that's what I have been doing for the last 3 years. So I was applying for software jobs and then I just saw this opportunity and randomly applied and it worked out. It's not like I was going behind cloud jobs because I didn't want to take that risk. I knew that my strengths are in software. So I gave more focus into applying for software jobs.
And tell us a little bit more about that. So let's say you submitted your, you found this job, like it was on like LinkedIn jobs, I'm guessing. And then you found it and you're like, oh, cool. Like you read through the job description. I'm guessing at the time your resume was actually tailored for like a dev, like a another software engineering role. So did you, at the time, did you have to like change anything, do anything specific to make it more tailored for that role?
So when you apply for jobs, you have to always tailor your CV into specific jobs. It's not like you can use the same CV for all the jobs. So depending on the job, you have to change your CV, you have to change your cover letter, and you have to do everything on your own. So you have to have customized CVs and cover letters for each and every job.
Yeah. If you were to try to put yourself in the shoes of that recruiter at the time, what do you think helped you make it into like even the interview stage, just from like your resume or your CV alone?
Yeah, I think it's my prior experience. So Like so far, I have worked in three different organizations. Every time when I move from one job to another job, my prior experience helped me. When I move from my first job to second job, the one I moved to work on blockchain. So at that point, I had some experience with Kafka, and they wanted someone who has strong experience with Kafka. So that experience helped me to move from my first job to the second job. And the second job, I got some experience with EKS. And from that job to the current job, the EKS experience helped me to got this opportunity. It's always my prior experience.
And these things are so hard to map out looking forward. Like when
Yeah.
you first...
I never planned that I want to ended up working as a cloud engineer. So it's not like I planned this journey. So every time when this opportunity came up, I took the opportunity.
What would you say to someone that says like, hey, Daham, like I want to get into cloud, so I'm not going to take any role that doesn't have cloud in the name. Like I want to be a cloud engineer full stop.
Yeah.
When I look for jobs on LinkedIn, I just search for cloud engineer. And if something doesn't mention cloud, I don't trust it. Like I'm not going to give it a go. What would you say to like that kind of approach to applying
Yeah.
for role?
If you're a fresher, if you're applying for your first job, I would say don't go behind just cloud jobs. So if you get a software development jobs, take the job and learn as much as possible, because at the end of the day, you are deploying software in the cloud. So it's always good to have the software development knowledge. It will help you. So if you're just looking for your first job, don't look, just look just for cloud jobs. Just take any good job which give you enough opportunities to learn. Yeah, because right now we have categorized this as multiple jobs like cloud engineer, software engineer, DevOps engineer, but we all work together. So your ultimate goal is to create software which users can access without any issues. So you are working on the same goal in three different teams. So it's always better to have the knowledge about all these areas.
Yeah, those are some really wise thoughts, to be honest. Do you think there's going to be a special, like a specific part of cloud you ever want to specialize in?
Yeah, I'm specializing in containers.
Mm.
So that's my specialization, and that's what I always wanted to specialize in, cloud domain.
Yeah.
And cloud also, you have like a lot of domains like networking, application deployment. And now, right now we have a lot of AI tools and data analytics. So there are a lot of tools available in cloud. You can specialize in anything you like, but I prefer this domain, containers and
Yeah.
Kubernetes.
Containers and Kubernetes for the win. For the win. That's cool. Thank you so much, Daham, for sharing like all of this about your journey so far. I think there's been more Q&A questions than I've been expecting, honestly. So I think we're gonna jump into like a few of the Q&A questions now, so to give everyone, you know, to give every question like the time that it deserves. So if it's okay with you, I'll start with a few questions. We have a question that says, how important is certification in getting a job?
I would say it's important, but right now I don't have a single cloud certification. But if you are getting to, if you are looking for your first job, certifications will help you. Because when I got my first job, CCNA helped me. So that was the proof that I had to tell that I know about networking. I didn't have any prior experience. So if you don't have much work experience in cloud, having a certificate will help you to prove that you know about cloud. But when you work in cloud industry for some time, more than certificates, what's important is your experience. You should be able to tell, I have done this, I have done this optimization, I have solved these complex problems. So those things add more value into your career than certificate. But when you're starting out, certificates are very important.
That's
I
cool.
won't say certificates are not important later in your career, but I'm saying it's very important when you're starting out.
Yeah.
But I don't recommend everyone to go and do most advanced certificates. You can just start with the basic ones, associate level certificates, because no point taking professional certificates. Just knowing things are not enough at that stage. You need to have experience. So I recommend taking associate level exams.
Yeah, cool. And sounds like associate level exams are a good way to go if you're at the entry level. Yeah. Nice. So thank you so much to Olumide and Syed as well for asking those questions. And we also have Deepa asking, you know, so is it at all possible to start as a cloud engineer as a fresher? Like, have you seen other people do that? So like the cloud engineers that you meet today, what have their journeys been like? Is it similar to yours?
Yeah, I have seen freshers starting as cloud engineer, but personally, I think cloud engineer job is more like intermediate role, because you need to know a lot of things about the fundamental. So that's my personal opinion, but I have seen a lot of people starting as freshers in cloud domain.
Yeah, cool. What do you think they did to like start as a fresher in cloud?
I think when you're starting as a fresher, they don't look at your prior experience. It's just they look at your enthusiasm, whether you know something about cloud, whether you are capable enough to learn things fast, because cloud keeps changing. It's not the same technology you had yesterday. It keeps evolving. So you need to keep up with the changes in the cloud domain, same with software development and in other IT domains. So they look at your ability to learn things fast.
Yeah.
So those will help you to stand out.
Cool. Another question is from Suraj asking, oh, it's a pretty specific question. So all good if this is actually quite relevant. Suraj wants to know, how important is data structure algorithms? How important is data structure algorithms in your career? I'm learning DSA, but is it really important?
It is important to crack interviews, because you need that. Without data structures algorithm, you can't crack interviews. That's true. And other than that, I don't find it very useful when you are doing your day-to-day job. But I have had few incidents which that I had to look at data structures algorithm to do few optimizations in algorithms. But I think that's like 5% of the time in your career you get to work with data structures and algorithm. But if you want to go through interviews, you need to learn data structures and algorithm.
Yeah. Oh, I love it. I love it.
That's
I think
the sad truth.
Yeah. It's true. Like I mean, I was learning that kind of stuff when I was studying at university. I'm like, oh man, like is this, are we actually gonna use this? But it's interesting to see that it actually gets mentioned in interviews. Like, it seems like employers actually want to know, like, can you just solve data structure algorithms? Was that the kind of interview that you got when you were applying for this cloud support engineering role too?
No, I was pretty happy about this this interview process, because I didn't get any question about theories. It's more like the fundamental concepts.
What kind of questions were they?
It's more like fundamentals, like how networks work, how HTTP protocol work, what is SSL certificate, how it works. So those are real fundamental you need to know.
Yeah.
So don't take it wrong that data structures algorithms are not important. It is important to practice your skills, but you won't directly use data structures or algorithms in your day-to-day job, unless you are working in a very specific domain.
Yeah.
But in a normal role, you won't get to work with those.
Yeah. It's also, sorry, there's a slight pivot, but it's interesting to hear you talk about those topics like SSL or networks, like how do they work for a role where you're actually almost specializing in containers.
Yeah.
Can you tell me more about like how interconnected all of these concepts are? Because I personally, if I was given a role about being a cloud support engineer for containers, I don't think my mind would instinctively say that, oh, I should study all of these other concepts too. So do you almost have like some, this sort of like bearing around like, oh, all of these concepts are kind of linked together?
Yeah, it's like when you get a problem, if you want to troubleshoot and narrow down where the problem is occurring, you need to know the big picture. Like when you get an issue that my application is responding my application is giving 502. So you need to know where to go and check. Maybe its application is down. Maybe something is blocking the request. Maybe the load balancers are not working. Maybe the certificates are failing. You still don't know. So you need to know everything. So having this fundamental knowledge helps you a lot to troubleshoot all these issues.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
very
it's
good
like
point.
When you're doing a bachelor's, you get to learn most of these things, but they don't directly teach you how HTTPS work, how SSL certificates work. But when you hear these words, try to learn, like try to go and do a Google search. What is SSL? How does that work? What is a three-way handshake? How does that work? So you need to learn all these things, because I have come up with some incidents. I had to check three-way handshake packets to see that the client is replying back, whether the client is receiving acknowledgement packets. It's like you have to go deep into that level.
Yeah.
So it's always good to know these things. So these
yeah.
are the things that help you to stand out, like not just knowing how to provision resources in cloud. Anyone can do that. That's very straightforward. If you go to the documentation, it's there. You just have to go through the documentation. Yeah. That won't help you to stand out.
Oh, wow. So it's almost like the core understanding of these concepts and how they relate together ends up being so important. Did you learn all of this by studying, like pen and paper? Do you think you learned?
You can't sit and study everything.
Yeah.
You have, like, whenever you hear something, you have to go and find. You have to be curious about things. When someone tells me something that I don't know, if I hear people are talking about something I don't know, I just go home and I research into that and see what they were talking about.
Yeah.
So if you keep doing this for some time, then gradually you learn a lot of things.
Yeah, mad respect to that. That's honestly like a huge learning mindset.
Yeah, because like I can remember when I joined my second company, they had pipelines. Like I was a software engineer. I just write code and I push to GitHub, and then automatically you get these deployments in your test environment. So no one wanted to know how these things work. Everyone write their codes and press a PR. Someone accept your PR, and then here you get your changes in the dev environment and you can test it. No one wanted to learn it, but I wanted to see what's happening in the pipeline. So I dig into each and everything. I check the configurations, the scripts they have implemented.
Yeah.
So that's how I got the opportunity to work in the DevOps domain in that company, because I was the only one who knew those things. For everyone else, it was just a black box.
Yeah. Yeah. It's, yeah, I find that really, really cool, because these concepts can naturally be so intimidating for people, because it's just so unknown. But from the way you talk about it, I get this sense that it's like you just have to start somewhere, and it's okay.
Yeah.
You have no clue where you are, where you're at. Don't expect to be the master straight away. Just
Yeah.
start somewhere and just be like, just like a little bit better than yesterday, or a little bit better than last week, or like just keep going. And eventually, like, it sounded like you became someone that became a lot more confident in DevOps, like little by little. So that's really cool. I do have two more questions I really want to get to ask before we round this up today, because there were two questions that were submitted even before this event started. And if we have extra time, I'll make sure to go through the rest of Q&A. Thanks everyone for your patience as well. So I want to make a big shout out to Rahul, who also has his camera on right now. So Rahul, give us a wave if you can hear this. Hi Rahul, good to see you. Now Rahul has asked a really good question here. What advice would you give to software engineers who are interested in cloud, but they're actually just unsure if it's the right move for them?
I don't know how to answer that question, whether it's the right move for them, because it's your personal choice. If you like to work in cloud domain, you can move to cloud domain. It might work out for you. It might not work out for you. So it's actually a personal choice. When I took this decision, it was my personal choice. I didn't plan about my future career. I didn't think about where to go from this role. All I wanted was to just learn about cloud as much as possible. when I get a new job, I go deep into that job. I learn as much as possible. But I think it's good for everyone, every software engineer, to work in cloud domain or DevOps domain for some time to master these skills. Because if you work as a software engineer for a few years, then you get comfortable with what you are doing. You get comfortable with writing code. So it's always better to get out of your comfortable zone and work in a different domain for some time, understand their perspective. Because day to day in my job, I get a lot of software engineers struggling with their pipelines, deployments. But again, if you know this, it'll help you to stand out. So if you get an opportunity, take it and learn it. And again, you can get back to software because you already have the skill to work as a software engineer.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Rahul, for submitting that question too. And it's a good point. Like at the end of the day, it's a personal choice, and it is something that you don't like have to do to continue in your career. I will have to call out that a lot of people get a little nervous, especially with like AI coming through and like so many companies moving into cloud, that it feels like it's like you got to jump on this ship or else you're going to be left behind. So did you ever feel that way about cloud? Kind of like, oh, like I just got to jump on this ship or else like I can't really find another kind of career path? Or do you feel like other people have kind of proven otherwise in your experience?
No, I used to think like that when I first heard about AI. I thought maybe, okay, AI is going to take over the software engineer job. But then when I think about cloud, AI is involved a lot in cloud. Like you have tools to debug, troubleshoot your issues in cloud. So you don't really need, in the future, you might not need a cloud engineer to troubleshoot your issues. But when you look at the actual industry, it's more than writing codes. It's more than just finding where the issue is. Engineer has a lot of things to do other than writing codes and debugging issues in cloud. So you don't have to worry about that. AI will play a big role in the industry, but still, if you have required skills, then you can stand out. And when it comes to AI, this is what I believe. I believe in future, a single engineer will have to wear multiple hats. Like right now, we have software engineers. They say, we don't know cloud. You have to go to cloud engineer. And cloud engineers say, I don't know software. You have to go back to software engineer. But AI makes your work easy. AI will do 50% of your work. Then you get more time to learn about cloud. You get more time to learn about DevOps. So you will get to learn two more things in one organization. So you will be the DevOps engineer. You will be the software engineer. You will be the cloud engineer.
Yeah.
So you have to be prepared for that.
It's truly not just like networks or security or DevOps, like not all of that in isolation, but really like all together.
You can be an expert now. You can be a security expert. I won't say everyone will be security experts. There will be experts, but in your day-to-day job, you will have to do something in every domain.
Yeah.
So there will be a dedicated cloud team, but you can't say it's not my job. You need to have that skill.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you so much. All right. So we just have actually, on your note, we actually had a lot of students ask questions about like whether or not they need to be very proficient in coding. They'll be like, hey, like, you know, I did a computer science degree, or, you know, I've been wanting to become a cloud engineer, but I'm not the strongest coder. You know, how proficient do I need to be? What is your advice around this?
Yeah, so if you want to become an expert in coding, it can even take up to 10 years. So I have worked with people who has 10 years of experience. Every time when I talk to them, I learn something new. You don't have to be that kind of expert in coding to get into cloud, because as a cloud engineer, you don't get to write a lot of codes, but you need to write a lot of scripts, automations in Python, Bash, Go. So you need to be able to write good quality scripts to automate your things in cloud. And also you need to have a decent knowledge in software engineering to understand how software works, how applications work together. You need to know what are the microservices, how applications connect to the database, and what is the database, what are the database queries you can execute. and how to connect to a load balancer, what are the API requests, how application logging works. So you need to know all of these things. So it's not like becoming a coding expert, but you need to have a good expertise in software development. That helps you. Because I'll give you one example. So recently I was working on one problem. This application was not running. It was stopping in the middle, but I was working with a software developer and they were not able to figure out what is causing that issue because there were no errors in the application. And as a cloud engineer, I can't do anything because if the application is not starting, it's not my problem. I can always push, it's not my problem. Application developers has to figure it out. But application developers can't figure it out because there are no errors. So it gets stuck there. But with my prior experience, I knew how it was a Spring Boot application. I knew how it's working. And then I know the flow. What is JPA doing, how it's connecting to the database. So that helped me to figure out the issue was with the database, and database was overwhelming at that time, too many things to process. So having that knowledge always helps you. So be a expert in software, that helps you, but you don't have to be an expert in coding.
Yeah. Awesome stuff. Thank you so much for sharing all of your all of your learnings and all the things that you've observed. I've really enjoyed this because it's just so cool to chat with someone that's really seen the entire journey from I was working with on-prem and then I moved into this role not expecting to be working with cloud, but I started to, and I worked really hard to learn on my own, got into all of these different skills. Now I'm working in a cloud role, and to hear how you think about studying learning cloud and how you go from following step-by-step guides to going into leading your own projects, that is extremely, extremely valuable. I think we get a lot of students in this community that say I'm very, very interested. I know this is what I want to do. I'm ready to put in the work, but I'm just a bit lost on how to get there. And I think with hearing with every story you hear on how someone ends up there, you get almost a bit more confidence on maybe this is a path or maybe that is a path. I really liked hearing how actually for yourself, it wasn't a drawn out path, looking forward. It was something that was just I picked up the skill and it eventually became something that was pivotal to being able to land the next role. It's very, very hard to decide things looking forward and just giving things a chance. It ends up paying off in ways that you wouldn't expect. So those are some really, really awesome learnings.